Hello friends, today I am going to begin chapter number 7 of a Spectrum's Brief History of Modern India. I have also made chapter number 5 and 6 of the same book, which are already added in the playlist. So please go back once and see the playlist. If you have not yet subscribed to my channel, please subscribe it and like this video. A lot of you had given me feedbacks in the previous chapters that the chapter is very lengthy, so I have tried to reduce the size of the chapter. Please let me know what all changes I can make further. So we will begin this chapter now. We had already seen in chapter 5 and 6 that British had established their suzerainty over India by the Battle of Plassey in 1757. From 1757 to 1857, British were trying to expand and consolidate their power in India, especially in the north part of India. However, this consolidation of power also exposed the character and policies of colonial rule in the north of India, and this caused a lot of discontent among the local people. Now, the first revolt of 1857 was the first large-scale uprising in India against the rule of British East India Company. We had seen in chapter 6 that there were many revolts that had taken place from 1757 up to 1857. However, they were very localized. But when we consider the revolt of 1857, this was a large scale uprising. That means it took place in a large part of India, and the revolt was very simultaneous, and it was very difficult for the British to control this revolt. Now, the genesis of this revolt lies in the oppressive and exploitative rule of British East India Company. Now, the rule of British East India Company had caused discontent among different sections of the society, which included rulers, sepoys, zamindars, peasants, traders, artisans, pandits, maulvis, etc. The simmering discontent burst in a violent form in 1857, and it shook the empire shook the British Empire to its very foundation. Now, the major causes. What are the major causes of revolt? So, the causes of revolt of 1857, like earlier uprisings, emerged from all aspects, that is socio, cultural, economic and political, of the daily existence of Indian population, cutting through all sections and classes. So now we will see the major causes that are that caused the revolt of 1857. First, economic causes. Now, there was a very heavy taxation under the new revenue settlement. The peasantry was never really able to recover from the disabilities that were imposed by the new and highly unpopular revenue settlement. Then there was impoverishment because of heavy taxation. And due to this, peasants had to resort to loans from moneylenders and traders at a very high rate. And this high debt burden led to summary evictions because of non-payment of taxes by the peasants. Now, the older system of zamindari was also forced to disintegrate. Then British rule also meant misery to the artisans and handicraft people. The annexation of Indian states by the company had cut off the major patronage of source of patronage of the artisans and handicrafts. And added to this, the British policy discouraged the Indian handicrafts and they promoted British goods. So the highly skilled Indian craftsmen was forced to look for alternative source of employment, which hardly existed. As a result, they came back to the agricultural land, and it led to the destruction of Indian economy. Then Indian trade and mercantile class was also crippled by the British because they imposed high tariff duties on the Indian made goods. At the same time, they imposed very low duties or almost low tariffs on the imported British goods. So by the mid 19th century, export of cotton and silk textile from India practically came to an end. Although India was a leader in case of export of silk and textiles, but it ended because of the discriminatory tariff policy of Britishers. Then free trade on one way वन वे फ्री ट्रेड किल्ड द इंडियन मैन्युफैक्चरर्स एंड दस इट इंक्रीज द मिजरीज इकोनॉमिक मिजरीज ऑफ पीपल. सो द रूइन ऑफ इंडियन इंडस्ट्री इंक्रीज द प्रेशर ऑन एग्रीकल्चर एंड द लैंड कुड नॉट सपोर्ट ऑल द पीपल. दस दिस रिजल्टेड इन लॉपसाइडेड डेवलपमेंट एंड पॉपुलाइजेशन ऑफ कंट्री इन जनरल. सो नाउ वी विल सी द पॉलिटिकल कॉजेज. ईस्ट इंडिया कंपनीज पॉलिसी ऑफ एग्रांडाइजमेंट एंड इट वॉज अकम्पनीड बाई ब्रोकन प्लेजेज एंड प्रोमिसज. सो दिस रिजल्टेड इन कंटेम्प्ट फॉर कंपनी एंड लॉस ऑफ पॉलिटिकल प्रेस्टीज बिसाइड्स कॉजिंग सस्पिशन इन द माइंड्स ऑफ ऑल रूलिंग प्रिंसेस इन इंडिया. सो दो द through the policies of effective control, subsidiary alliance and doctrine of lapse, Britishers had gained control over a large tract of India. Now because of these policies, the Indian princes no longer trusted the British East India Company, and thus this caused animosity between the princes and East India Company. Then second reason is absentee sovereignty-ship character of British rule. That means the character of British rule was foreign and alien. The British people did not come to settle in India. They were here just for trade and for profit. And this foreign and alien rule caused people to see the entire company as with the eyes of suspicion. And lastly, the last political factor is pseudo-religious causes. Now the activities of Christian missionaries who followed the British flag in India were looked with suspicion. So the Christian missionaries also tried to convert Indians, and then there were attempts of social religious reforms like abolition of sati, then widow remarriage and women's education. Now these things were seen by large sections of Indian population as interference in social and religious domains of Indian society by outsiders. And then the fears of Indians were also compounded by making laws such as Religious Disability Act 1856, which had modified Hindu customs. For example, it declared that a change of religion did not debar a son from inheriting the property of father. So this all caused lot of discontentment among the minds of Indians. Then there was also influence of outside events like Afghan war, Punjab war, where British had to suffer through various reverses. So obviously this led to psychologically Indians came to see that British were not so strong and they can be defeated. Then there were some military causes as well. So in the conditions of service in Company's army and the cantonments were in conflict with religious beliefs and prejudices of sipahis. So there was restriction on wearing caste and sectarian marks, and there were also rumors of the conversion activities under the Britishers. And all this was interpreted by Indian sipahis who were conservative as an interference in their religious affairs. Besides this, to a religious Hindu, crossing the sea meant loss of caste. However, in 1856, Lord Canning's government proposed a General Service Enlistment Act, which decreed that all future recruits of Bengal Army would have to give an undertaking that they can be made to serve anywhere required by the government. So this also caused resentment in the minds of sipahis. Then Indian sipahis were also unhappy with emoluments when compared to the British counterpart. And dissatisfaction was also on the reason that they were not given the foreign service allowance while serving in Sindh or Punjab. Then the annexation of Awadh, which was home of many sipahis, also led to inflammation of feelings of sipahis. Then Indian sipahis was also made to feel subordinated and discriminated racially in the matters of promotion and privileges. So these discontent were not limited only to the military matters. It reflected the general opposition to British rule. Now we will see the beginning and spread of revolt. So these are all causes, there was a lot of discontentment among the minds of sepoys, among the minds of princes, among the minds of peasants, among the minds of artisans, among the minds of craftsmen and general people, populace. However, all this was gradually building up for so many years, but the spark was given by something else. So the reports about mixing bone dust in atta and introduction of Enfield rifles enhanced the sepoys' dissatisfaction with the government, and the greased wrapping paper of cartridge of the new rifle had to be bitten off before loading, and grease was reportedly made of beef and pig fat. So grease cartridges, so because it was reportedly made of beef and pig fat, it meant a loss of religion for both Hindu and Muslim recruits. However, the British government did nothing to allay the fears of sepoys. Then grease cartridge did not supply a new cause of discontentment, but it gave an occasion for discontentment to come out into open. Now, rumbling before the revolts, even before the revolt started, there were also rumblings of resentment in various cantonments. For example, the 19th Native Infantry at Behrampur refused to use the newly introduced Enfield rifle, and there was a mutiny which broke out in February 1857. So because of this mutiny, the entire 19th Native Infantry of Behrampur was disbanded in March 1857. Similarly, a young sepoy of 34th Native Infantry named Mangal Pandey fired at his sergeant major of his unit at Barakpur, and he was also executed on April 8 and was executed, and his entire regiment was disbanded in May. Now, the revolt started basically at Meerut. So what happened in Meerut was, on April 24, 1857, 90 men of 3rd Native Cavalry, they refused to accept the grease cartridges of Enfield rifle. And because of this, on May 9, 1857, out of these 90, 85 were dismissed and they were sentenced to 10 years of imprisonment. So the same night, or in the early hours of 10th May 1857, the Indian soldiers who were stationed at Meerut, they rose in mutiny, they released their imprisoned comrades, killed their officers and unfurled the banner of revolt. And after sunset, they started off to Delhi. And the Delhi became the nerve center of revolt. So the arrival of soldiers from Meerut created a frenzy among soldiers and civilian populace in Delhi, who rose en masse to give vent to their opposition to the British rule. The soldiers at Delhi killed their own European officers, including Simon Fraser, who was the political agent. Now, this aged and powerless Bahadur Shah Zafar, or Bahadur Shah II, was proclaimed the Emperor of India. So, after the capture of Delhi, or after the fall of Delhi, the revolt is spread to major other parts of India, specifically in Kanpur, Lucknow, Bareilly, Bihar, Jhansi, and even Faisalabad. So, the various centers of revolt, for example, Delhi. At Delhi, the nominal and symbolic leadership belonged to Mughal ruler Bahadur Shah, but the real command lay with the court of soldiers headed by General Bhakt Khan. And he led the revolt of Bareilly troops and brought them to Delhi. So the court consisted of 10 members, 6 were from army and 4 were from civilian departments. Now this court conducted the affairs of state in the name of emperor. Emperor Bahadur Shah was the weakest link in the chain of leadership of the revolt of Delhi. Now his weak personality, old age and lack of leadership created political weakness at the nerve center, which was Delhi. Now at Kanpur, the natural choice was Nana Sahib, who was the adopted son of last Peshwa Bajirao II. He refused the family title and was banished from Pune. And he was living near Kanpur. That is, he was living at Bethur near Kanpur. Nana Sahib expelled the English from Kanpur, and he proclaimed himself the Peshwa and acknowledged Bahadur Shah as the Emperor of India, and he declared himself to be the governor of Bahadur Shah. Then at Lucknow, Begum Hazrat Mahal took over the reins, where the rebellion broke out on June 4, 1857, and the popular sympathy was in the favor of a deposed son, deposed Nawab. Now the son of Begum Hazrat Mahal, that is Birjis Qadir, he was proclaimed the Nawab, and regular administration was organized with important offices shared equally between Muslims and Hindus. Then at Bareilly, Khan Bahadur, a descendant of former ruler of Rohilkhand, was placed in command. He was not enthusiastic about the pension being granted by the British, so he organized an army of 40,000 soldiers and he offered a very stiff resistance to British. At Bihar, the revolt was led by Kunwar Singh, the zamindar of Jagdishpur. He was an old man in his 70s and he had a grudge against British who had deprived him of his estate. He unhesitatingly joined the Sepoys when they arrived from Ara from Dinapur or Danapur. Then in Jhansi, Rani Lakshmi Bai assumed the leadership of Sepoys at Jhansi. Lord Dalhousie, the Governor General, had refused to allow her adopted son to succeed the throne after her husband Raja Gangadhar Rao died, and he had annexed the state by application of doctrine of lapse, thereby driving Jhansi. So driven out of Jhansi by British forces, she gave the battle cry, "Main apni Jhansi nahi dungi." She was joined by Tatya Tope, who was a close associate of Nana Sahib after the loss of Kanpur. Then at Faizabad, Maulvi Ahmadullah was an outstanding leader of revolt. He was a native of Madras and had moved to Faizabad in north, where he fought a stiff battle against the British troops. He emerged as one of the revolt's most acknowledged leaders once it broke out in Awadh in May 1857. So although there was a leadership which was provided by these people, these important people, the revolt could not be sustained beyond 1859. By 1859, the revolt was oppressed very brutally by Britishers. Now, besides these main leaders, the sacrifices that were made by common masses were also immense and innumerable. For example, Shah Amal, a local villager of Pargana Barot, which is in Baghpat, Uttar Pradesh, is very notable. Now, this man, Shah Amal, he organized the headmen and peasants of 84 villages, marching at night from village to village, urging people to rebel against British hegemony. Shah Amal also sent supplies to the mutineers in Delhi and prevented all official communication between British headquarters and Meerut. Unfortunately, Shah Amal was killed in July 1857 by an English officer, Dunlop. Now, the suppression of revolt. Revolt was finally suppressed. By 1859, entire revolt was suppressed. The nerve center was Delhi, so British captured Delhi on September 20, 1857 after a prolonged and bitter fighting. John Nicholson, the leader of Sikhs, was badly injured and wounded. Then Bahadur Shah was taken as prisoner and the royal princes were captured and butchered on blank. They were shot on blank by Lieutenant Hudson. The emperor was exiled to Rangoon, where he died in 1862. Then one by one, all the great leaders of revolt fell. Military operations for recapture of Kanpur were closely associated with the recovery of Lucknow. So at Kanpur, Sir Wheeler and Colin Campbell had oppressed the revolt by December 6, 1857. Nana Sahib was defeated at Kanpur and he escaped to Nepal in early 1859. And he was never heard of again. Now his close associate Tatya Tope escaped into jungles of central India, but he was captured while he was asleep in April 1859 and he was put to death. And then the Rani of Jhansi had died on battlefield earlier in June 1858. Jhansi was recaptured by Sir Hugh Ross. By 1859, Kunwar Singh, Bakht Khan, Khan Bahadur Khan of Bareilly, Rao Sahib, the brother of Nana Sahib, and Maulvi Ahmadullah were all dead, while the Begum of Awadh was compelled to hide in Nepal. So at Banaras, a rebellion had been organized, which was mercilessly suppressed by Colonel Neil. By the end of 1859, British authority over India was fully re-established. So now we will see why the revolt failed. So the first reason is there was a lack of all India participation. There was limited territorial spread, which was one factor, and there was no all India veneer about the revolt. The eastern and southern and western parts of India, they remained more or less unaffected. Then second reason is all classes did not join. Certain classes and groups did not join, in fact, and they in fact worked against the revolt. For example, big zamindars, they acted as breakwaters to the storm. Even the Awadh talukdars backed off once the promise of land restitution was given to them. Then educated Indians viewed the revolt as backward looking, and the revolt was considered as supportive of feudal order and a reaction to the traditional conservative forces of modernity. So these educated people thought that British would usher in an era of modernization. Then third reason is poor arms and equipment. So the Indian soldiers were poorly equipped when they were fighting. They were generally fighting with swords and spears, whereas the European soldiers were equipped with latest weapons like Enfield rifles. Then fourth reason is uncoordinated and poorly organized revolt. The principal leaders like Nana Saheb, Tatya Tope, Kuvar Singh, Lakshmi Bai, they were all acting very isolatedly, and there was no good communication between these people. Whereas on the other hand, the British was strategy was very organized and very well communicated, and there was no unified ideology. The mutineers, they lacked a clear understanding of colonial rule. They did not have any forward-looking program or a coherent ideology. They did not even have a political perspective or social alternative. The rebels were just having different grievances, and they were representing those grievances in the form of current turmoil. Then the modern nationalism was as yet unknown in India. Then one important factor about the revolt is that there was a huge Hindu-Muslim unity. During the entire revolt, there was complete cooperation between Hindus and Muslims at all levels, including people, soldiers and leaders. So all the rebels, they acknowledged Bahadur Shah Zafar as the emperor of India, who was a Muslim. Then the Mughal imperial capital, that is Delhi, was considered as a nerve center of a revolt. Now the nature of revolt, lot of people have said lot of things about the nature of revolt. For example, R.C. Mazumdar and S.N. Sen said that it was not an organized national revolt. R.C. Mazumdar even went further to say that this was neither the first nor national war of independence. See, it was not first because there were many other revolts which took place from 1757 to 1857, which we have already read in chapter number 6. And it was not even national because, as we had seen, the western, central and the southern part of India did not participate at all in these revolts. Then V.D. Savarkar, he said that it was the first war of independence. Whereas the Britishers, they have a different view of the revolt. They don't even consider it as a revolt. They call it as elitist in character, as said by Eric Stokes. Whereas Lawrence and Sally, they called it a mere sepoy mutiny. And James Outram, he called it as a Mohammedan conspiracy, and which made a capital of Hindu grievances. So the revolt, there are a lot of opinions about the revolt. However, in modern India, we still consider revolt of 1857 as first war of independence, and no doubt it was a very large outbreak, and it was the first large outbreak against the alien rule. Now, consequences of revolt. What happened due to revolt? First thing is that happened was revolt was a turning point in the history of India. It brought in a lot of changes in the system of administration and the policies of British government. So even before the revolt could be suppressed, British government parliament on August 2, 1858 passed an act for the better government of India. So the act declared Queen Victoria as the sovereign of British India, and it provided for appointment of Secretary of State, who was a member of British cabinet, and the direct responsibility of the administration of country was assumed by British Crown, and company's rule was totally abolished. So this revolt led to the death of company's rule in India. Then assumption of government of India by sovereign of Great Britain was announced by Lord Canning at Darbar at Allahabad on Queen's proclamation issued on November 1, 1858. As per the Queen's proclamation, there was an era of annexation and expansion had ended, and British promised to respect the dignity and rights of native princes. Then Indian states were henceforth to recognize the paramountcy of British crown, and they were to be treated as a part of single charge. People of India were promised freedom of religion without interference from British officials. Then another major consequence was a reorganization of army. Army, which was at the forefront of outbreak, was thoroughly reorganized, and British military policy came to be dominated by idea of divide and rule. Then British could no longer depend on Indian loyalty, so the number of Indian soldiers was reduced, and the number of European soldiers was increased. The concept of divide and rule was adopted, with separate unit being created on base of caste, community, region, etc. And next thing happened was earlier reformist zeal or the self-confident Victorian liberalism evaporated, and British began to believe that Indians were beyond reform. Then next thing which happened was policy of divide and rule began after the revolt of 1857. British used one class or community against another, and thus there was irredeemable deterioration in the social fabric of country. Even today we see that there are a lot of fissures on the basis of communal lines. All this was a gift of, or all this was a consequence of the revolt of 1857. Then another thing that British did was exploitation of Indian economy without any fear. Then last thing that happened because of revolt was racial hatred and suspicion between Indians and English. So the proponents of imperialism in India dubbed entire Indian population as unworthy of trust and subjected Indians to insults and racial prejudices. Then this widened the gulf between rulers and ruled. Then the significance of revolt. Revolt had a lot of significances which you will see until the end of British rule in India. For British, the revolt showed the shortcomings of company's administration and the army, and the shortcomings of army, which were quickly rectified. As a result of the revolt, British could work on their policies, and they restructured their administration and army in such a way that there was no revolt that happened for next 50 years. Now for Indians, the revolt brought into open the grievances of people as well as of sepoys. Then secondly, it established a tradition of resistance, and it inspired the course of national struggle of for freedom. So this is all in this chapter. We will continue the next chapter in next class. Thank you.